Okay. Now the key is with shingles is that is not to exert myself. Hi, folks. I have a herpes virus called shingles. You can Google it, or I'll tell you a lot about it tonight. I've learned a lot about it, but it rides on the nervous system. It's a reactivation of the chicken pox from when you were a kid. It comes as a result of you either being 60, living in a third world country, or having my lifestyle, which apparently is high stress or low health. I'm going to go with the latter. So, you know, I went to New York with Dino. Had a good time. And
was this pre-shingles?
I think I got the shingles. I think I got a fever.
For the flavor.
Is it true in New York, and then I got the flavor of the shingles on the way back.
Is it true that some people call you shingles, Dick?
Yeah.
Sorry.
Is that Schrab's
car? My comedy car alarm went off outside. What the fuck?
All right, well, it's stuff like that that I'd like to keep to a minimum.
Who has a car alarm in 2018?
Someone should check that, right?
I want to thank the production crew because, well, first of all, I want to say to the subscribers.
Schrab, is that your car?
I hope so.
I mean, it's me. This isn't helping. Here are some of the things that...
Shingles loves car alarms.
The doctor told me not to do.
Listen to car alarms.
Work out. Go to therapy.
Don't go to therapy.
I didn't do the weekend Dracula show, the super tight like finale. Like these are fun things for me, but you know, I'm taking it easy. I have to not like even good stress is bad stress because this is a nerve, this is a virus that lives in your nerve endings. So I'm trying to take it very easy. So we did a little soft open, a little soft warm open. For those of you who are listening for free, that's cool. That doesn't make me...
But what you don't know is that Dan is laying in a kind of a cool, like blonde wood
I'm
IKEA
sitting in bed
situation
with bed. A bag of hard-boiled eggs that Spencer got me.
He's got some Minecraft-flavored bedding.
Some Eggland's best eggs.
Can you open these for me, sweetie?
I'd love to.
You're just eating eggs out of a bag?
Yeah. Lysine.
What?
The herpes virus that makes up shingles doesn't like lysine, which is weird because the dinosaurs in Jurassic Park love it. They need it. In the book, anyway. They kind of fucked off with that in the movie. I mean, they didn't really talk about the lysine dependency.
I love lysine.
Do you think that lysine is the reason why Velociraptor is cheetah speed?
Yeah.
Wait, anyway. So you're eating a hard-boiled egg out of a plastic pouch.
It's full of vitamin A or something.
Vitamin A? Like,
yeah. Can you hear the herpes screaming?
It's pissed. It's downright ornery.
Anyways. Now, don't go.
Is it going to scar on your head or is that going to go away?
Well, you can see this one that's right in the middle of my forehead. It's it could leave a divot. It's kind of cool, I got to say, when you get a disease that's like has like a sci-fi twist to it, I can at least get into that and get through the searing pain, which, by the way, has subsided. I'm not in any pain.
Yay.
I mean, I was a little tingling, but I think that's because I'm on these meds every time. I notice like a half hour after I take the meds. All right, slow down, Harmon. Fucking stop talking a mile a minute.
Get your lysine, Harmon. Get your lysine.
Just get your groovy voice back on. We've got some very low-energy, mild-mannered New York friends that are going to be joining us in a second. They're going to really keep me calm. They're from the East Coast where the vibes are chill.
Yeah.
And anyways,
where you get shingles with Dino.
It's
apparently.
What was I just saying?
I say hey, Zach, you got some music for us? Lay it on us.
Well.
Cold open is over.
Oh, okay.
I think this open's about to heat up. You know what I'm saying?
Where's our music, Zach?
Oh, so it's sort of like, you know, when you get chicken pox when you're a kid. This is the cool stuff I get, at least.
Topical.
Yo. If we're rapping, we're rapping low.
Time's up.
And slow. Beat. Down those chicken pox. Turn up the rocks. Make them like pebbles. Motherfucker. Bass to the treble. Whoa. Whoa. Don't fuck with me, not today.
Yeah,
I need low energy. Gotta relax in my Minecraft bed. Gotta do some rhymes off the top of my head. I say snoop, loop, a doopity doop. I fucked your mama in the laundry chute. I put pajamas on the back of my neck.
From beautiful uptown Burbank, Harmontown is once again in sessions.
Oh,
we have the supine Dan Harmon eating hard-boiled eggs out of a garage station fucking bag. I'm your comptroller, Jeff Davis, a game master extraordinaire, Spencer Crittenden. Let's give it up for your shingles-ridden mayor. Before he succumbs to illness and syphilitic madness, your mayor is Dan Harmon.
Thank you. See, I didn't understand your energy.
Yeah, we didn't know what was happening.
We both just realized, oh, he's a slave to the format. You're like, I mean, in a good way, you're a professional.
Yeah. I'm trying to keep
you're
some,
like, guys, we're not, some consistency. We haven't started
the show
yet.
That was a great instinct. You were thinking.
I was more comfortable with a kind of just a totally awkward, experimental, no title sequence show.
You got the facial chicken pox, eating some eggs, ate a million cocks.
Whoa, that's okay. Don't want you to be homophobic today, because we got our East Coast friends coming up in a second. We're going to make amends with the whole nation and my chicken pox. Got the herpes virus like bagels and lox. They go together. Birds of a feather, podcasting pros in the sunny weather. They came out to visit. Fucked your mama like my name was Limp Bizkit.
All right. Yeah.
What can you rap a little bit about your Minecraft pillows and medic?
Yeah, I don't mind being told what to do because I need to keep my nervous system unexerted. So, all right, I'll rap about my blankets. Minecraft's on them. Word. Fuck.
Aw, yeah.
Jesus Christ.
Have
congratulations.
You
have a eat slave
egg.
Rapper now.
Fucking hell yeah.
All right, let's
blankets.
Look, I want to
bring. Are you comfy? Are you okay over there?
I feel pretty good, and I want Steve Levy got on this. I don't know who put the bulk of the physical
Steve
work
Levy
in.
Made it with Nolan.
I'm obviously surrounded by a lot of people who care about me, and I don't say that enough.
Oh, that's nice. Thank you.
It's 8:11. Get in here with
you. All right.
Have you got the chicken pox before, Jeff?
I did when I was like 5.
Golden. You're golden.
Am I gonna get face AIDS from
nope.
you?
It's face herpes and no. Did you
Is
have chicken pox
herpes?
When you were a kid?
I did, so I'm good?
Yeah.
All right.
Apparently, you could potentially get chicken
Well, that's
pox.
The neat thing. I just want to say this, and then we'll bring up our guests, because our real guest is the face herpes that I have. So I want to introduce them, too.
Should we bring your face herpes out and talk to them for a while?
Well, they've come out. That's what I think is kind of neat. It's like, because it's like, that's why I think we like Ridley Scott's Alien movie, is because, it resonates, that Giger, like, stuff, that parasitic, like, something's bursting out of you. These are when you had chicken pox when you were a kid, you mostly like got rid of them out of your system. Like you basically killed most of them, whether you got vaccinated or had them, same difference. But there's like bands of gorilla, G-U-E-R, gorilla, like the same virus, like it gets. It hides in this certain kind of nerve cell. I don't know why. That nerve cell makes it possible for them to stay alive, but asleep. And so they just hang out. And if your immune system gets low enough, basically it's like your immune system is always on patrol. And I imagine these things poke their head out once in a while and get beat the fuck down. And then, so if you assume if you're, I was talking to Julianne Smolinski, who I hope doesn't mind outing her as someone who's also had this. She said that a bunch of TV writers have had it. Like it's like a vitamin D deficiency kind of like schlubby disease.
Should we get all the Starburns audio podcast together and have a shingles party? Like where we all expose ourselves to
But
it?
It's kind of neat because it's like it's a disease that you cured when you were a kid. That it's like the same virus hid in one type of cell, which is your nerve cell. It's not like a nerve disease. It's a virus that could only hide in that type of nerve cell. And that's why it only ever happens on one side of your face or body. That's how my doctor like figured it out right away. And you can actually trace the cranial nerve path that mine are on. I'm lucky because they're on my face. You get them on your back. You get them on your leg. You don't notice them for 2 weeks.
I'll take the back.
Yeah, but if you don't notice them, then you get that belt of blisters and stuff.
Oh, yeah, because I did a little research, and like people get a big band of it on one side of their body.
Yeah, but these little guys, they wake up. and girls. You're welcome.
You are so shingles woke.
Take it back, babies. They wake up in these nerve cells and they go, oh shit, I think this guy's either 60 or living in Nicaragua and drinking like lead water, maybe Detroit, and he's down for the count. Let's make a break for it, Red Rover. But they're stuck on these nerve paths and they go straight for the surface of the skin. They're like, let's cause chicken pox again. So basically, like, you can't give shingles to anybody. You can only give shingles to yourself. Shingles are a kind of like sequel to chicken pox that you get because your immune system gets so low that the Riddler comes back to fuck with Batman, you know, like, even though he was like beaten in the first movie.
I'm not going to contract this by being in bed with you at.
The only thing you could possibly get is if you were chickenpox free as a kid for some reason, if you were like a boy in a bubble and they let you out, and then so you didn't have chickenpox ever, and you were next to me when my head exploded with these gross blisters, which they've already done and they're finished. But if 2 days ago you had rubbed your forehead on mine, you would have gotten chickenpox.
I've already given you crabs just by being here for the last 10 minutes.
And I've gotten bored of myself. Am I right, people? Let's bring up our... Who applauded that?
We all did. America did.
Is that Schrab?
Fucking Schrab.
No, I don't think it was.
No, it
was
Schrab.
Let's just believe it was.
Oh, by the way, Schrab, we're gonna take Schrab to Boston. You know, there was a huge outcry. I think about 7 people retweeted him. It's just too much pressure from the 7 people that he pretends to be when he changes accounts. And
I just want to say that's a really generous thing that Schrab did to
It's just money, Spencer.
Wait, you're accusing Schrab of making up false accounts so he can
get a free trip?
Blast us.
No. Let's not talk about finances right now. Let's bring up our guest. I was just listening to their original podcast. We're in our 300s or something like that, and it makes us feel like we should quit. Like these guys have been doing podcasting since 2005. Like I think unless there's something about their episode codes that I'm not understanding, they're like in their mid 2000s.
Is that right?
On their original podcast, which is Keith and the Girl, right? Let's just bring them up and we can ask them all of the questions that I don't know.
I kind of want to stay in bed, but because of the blanket and my wool suit, I'm roasting in here. It's really warm.
Well, you do what you want. Let's bring up. I want to make sure I don't fuck up their names, but let's bring up our new friends, Keith Malley and Chemda Khalili.
All right, Chemda and Keith.
Hi, Keith.
Now.
Hi, Chemda.
Hello. Jeff, can you shake his hand for me?
You know what's weird is it changes my behavior too. Well, you know, you have a scab on your forehead, and you have I feel like I owe people this. I have to tell people I have shingles
because normally you'd be in a 3-piece suit and.
Well, normally I'd at least shake hands or hug or whatever anyone else wanted to do, but like it changes my behavior because I don't know what people's relationship with the word shingles is, and then you meet someone and they say, "I have it." All right.
Our relationship is now Dan Harmon. So
yeah. Anyways, I met you guys awkwardly rolling out of an Uber with a gallon of green tea and a bag of hard-boiled eggs.
And 25 eggs. I thought it was funny how Jeff asked you, so it's not contagious, is it? Is it too bad that I'm here after the fact? And then, no, I don't think so. That's good enough for me. That's how we try to have safe sex in 2018, right?
Yeah,
you're good,
really
right?
Not.
I'm good. Okay.
I'm mostly made of Fernet Branca right now. I don't think viruses can live in the horrible, caustic environment of my blood system.
I mean, the only thing that you could do is, I mean, I agree with you. Like, nothing really that lands on me can really set up shop there. Like, they'll be like, what the fuck is this Irish rock garden?
When you first saw it, did you think, oh, great, another blackout? Or do you really think it is medical?
I thought that because I had a massive head, not massive, massive for a writer, a head wound. I had a blackout kind of weekend at Tribeca. Since I couldn't remember how I had injured my head, and then I had this, like, I started feeling this pain going down half of my face, and I was like, oh, I guess since there's no such thing as coincidences, I must have like passed out and smacked my head on the nightstand and maybe just slept there like a like a cartoon drunk for an hour,
that
or a real
most
life drunk.
Logical thing that could have happened.
Yeah. Yeah, I was like piecing it together. And I was like, maybe I like fell down, slept on something weird that the hotel staff doesn't wash as much as the pillowcases or something. And then it just then I could see I like looked close in the mirror after I got back to LA and I was like, no, there's something blooming. And then
that's good news. Like for a split second, do you think, man, maybe I do have to quit drinking? And then you're right. Like, oh, no, shingles.
Yeah, for a while I started thinking, oh, I got shingles on my head too. Right. And the doctor's like, no, you fell down drunk. I looked at your head wound very carefully. I wanted to make sure it wasn't shingles on your head. It's not. You're an alcoholic.
So what's the prognosis? Like it just drifts away after time? You're taking medication for this?
Yeah. I'm one of the lucky ones. You'll never hear a shingles story this fortunate from most people because if you don't catch it in time, it can be a solid. My friend Julianne had it 2 years ago. She said it was for 19 days. It's like two weeks ish, 20 days. And if it just runs its course, which it just will, for a lot of people, you get this like neuralgia. I think that's what it's called. It's like this deep nerve pain that can last for 2 years because of the damage it causes coming out.
Have you ever spoken so sexy from bed?
It's a sexier. Why do I think that?
I mean, I'd be remiss to not if either of you guys want to spend some time in here, but
it looks more comfortable than this seat. I'm gonna give it a go.
Yeah, okay, come on in, Hemda. Yeah. I'm
gonna take off my shoes because I'm not an animal like Jeff. But we're not judging. We're not. It's a safe space.
I am an animal. You're right about that.
I feel
especially in the IKEA blonde wood futon.
I'm one of those people for whom it's more rude to take my shoes off because of how gross my feet are.
And Hemda, you came in wearing kind of what amounts to a blanket already. You came already bedded.
Yes, I understood what this podcast was about.
So you guys have been at it since 2005.
Yes.
Like you were podcasting before maybe they even had a word for it.
Honestly, yeah, there was still the iPod, and there wasn't a category on iTunes for it.
Mm-hmm. Why? How do you keep doing it? Because I was listening to your most recent episodes on the way here, and you clearly—I don't know how you started energy-wise, but you seem very happy to be doing it still and very good at it.
I do have a dream to take back. We have a premium program where you hear all our shows. Where you can hear everything from 13 years ago. So I want to take that first show and redo it and not tell anybody.
Just like act like it's like an adaptation, like a Gus Van Sant remake.
They're so polished for the first show. They're not.
You guys do sound polished, though. You sound like you have the right amount of like radio people in you.
I'll take right amount.
Like you're not. It would be an insult, I think, to podcasters to say you sound like radio people.
Right, but I get it. I'll take it. Yeah.
But I mean, it's like you guys are professional, is what I mean. You sound like you keep you don't do what I do and just have people on and just talk over them.
But how great is that, though? To be able to just, what am I wearing today? Who gives a shit? Like how fun that is.
How much do you guys plan your?
We plan probably at least 3 hours for an hour show.
So you get right before, or do you have a meeting in the middle of the week?
We get together 3 hours before the show to prep for that with our producer, Andrea, and a couple interns sometimes. And then they prep us for the guest and also news. And then I have to fight with Keith about how many rape cases we have to talk about on the show that day.
There's a lot.
He's fascinated by weird
rape
stories.
These are just Keith's open rape cases. Right?
I'm like, listen, what do we think?
What's Keith's angle on those cases? Is it...
He's just floored.
I am not pleased. That's my catchphrase.
It's his version of me too. He's just like I'm giving them all the attention.
Oh, is it really more like that? Is it like, no. hey, did you hear about this monster so and so, or is it like a true crimey kind of thing?
I think when the story's so amazing, I have to tell it, like, you know. But then it's sad news. It's a woman got into the wrong car. The worst thing happens. She gets into another car for help. The worst thing happens. I'm like, I don't know. I wish somebody told me this story.
And then he looks at me and goes, and we're a comedy podcast. And I'm like, I'm supposed to find the funniest thing about this rape story that you just told me?
Yeah, and then I say, good luck. I say, and Khanda, go.
Forgive me for not knowing what your show is, because I don't listen to a whole lot of podcasts. What is the, like...
The one we should be plugging is the one that's on Starburns.
Yeah, who cares about the Keith and the girl? So there's we also started because five shows a week wasn't enough. We started my opening line, and that's where we talked to artists and comedians about the very first humiliating times on stage.
Okay. Yeah. Oh, so that's not the one that's been going since 2005.
The one since 2005 is Keith and the Girl. That's 5 days a week. It's mostly a comedy show, but we will talk about Cosby being found guilty, this kind of thing.
Yeah, that was fun, wasn't it?
That was was fun. And
sad because he's a hero when you're a kid, right. And then also you find out he's been a villain since we were kids.
Right, and I was talking to Hannibal Buress, the person that did the stand-up that got everything started.
Yeah, and hooray for him on that one.
Hooray for him. He doesn't like it, though, because he's afraid he's being seen as that's the person, when meanwhile he has jokes. But I'm like, who cares? You're a superhero. You'll get your jokes in there. I don't know. I think it would be great to...
It's not his favorite thing to be associated directly with that.
Yeah,
I can imagine. But he still provided a service.
Yes. And all this teaches, too, is that, yes, when you're at a comedy club, record the show. You don't know what they're going to say. Right? If some asshole wasn't there with their phone...
Jeff can't tell if you're serious or not.
I honestly don't know if I am or not. I just saw The Big Sick.
Yes, we wouldn't know if Kramer was racist.
Right. I watched The Big Sick, and, you know, the guy's doing stand-up, and then there's a heckler in the audience. Well, long story short, they fall in love. What am I learning? Heckle, take out your phone. Do whatever you want. Yes.
You know what I want to know? This
do
is
what you want.
Do what you want.
This is off topic, but you took out a light bulb in New York in your hotel and then smashed it on the ground.
Thank you for listening.
Did you ever find out why your brain did that?
No. Do you think maybe it was the beginning of the herpes virus that was making me do things?
You think so? You think your herpes was
talking
to you?
I want to give myself the benefit of the doubt, or rather I should say, the reason I say I did it on purpose is because I don't want to let myself off the hook and say, oh, I slipped. But because here's what I definitely did on purpose. I looked at a light bulb cover and I was like, huh. And I just wanted to pull it off.
Why? What was fascinating about the light bulb?
I wanted to see how easy. I wanted to say, does that just come right off?
And it did. It just pulled right off.
Or does it
screw?
You're
talking about the casing that enclosed the bulb.
Like a globe of glass over the bulb to make it a little softer. And I was like, oh, it's keeping that on. Just not being pulled.
Your own curiosity is the only thing that keeps it on there.
Lack of curiosity keeps it on.
When he tells you stories, is it tempting to say, were you drinking? Or do you just have to?
No, because Dan and I live in a state of half inebriation.
Sometimes he asks, were you sober? Like, if it gets confusing, like it's a story about me, finding my car keys.
Our friend Greg Proops severed a tendon in his thumb by doing the exact same thing. He was in London and pulled the...
Does he have shingles too?
No, not that I'm aware of. It might be in his back.
Yeah.
I will have to check. A bulb went out. He tried to pull the casing off and the glass shattered.
But the bulb went out. That's like half a reason to do it, right?
Yeah, that's a full reason.
Right.
That is a full reason. You're right. I did the math on it.
I still would have called somebody and said, hey, would you do this
for me? Well, I'm Polish. I would have called two people.
We just went back to 1980.
How many Polish people does it take to wonder about
to tell
about
this
a light
joke
casing?
in 2018?
I don't. I'm gonna. That guy you can hear in the back is Rob Schrab. It's don't worry about him.
He should just be lav mic'd over
what
there.
I wanted
There's
to
no
think
reason for Rob
it,
to not
w-
have a microphone
I wanted to
on.
Think that because we all evolved from the same amoeba, basically, and then even though we branched off. That there's some part of us that's similar to the moth when we get that drunk, that we're just like, that's why drunk guys do what a moth would do if it had hands, which is just fuck with a light bulb.
A Danto
flame. You were in a hotel room, I take it.
What's that?
You were in a hotel?
Yeah.
Yeah, there's also a lack of permanence in hotels.
Well, it's also mystery, too. You know how your own light fixtures work.
Do you really?
Well, when you first get a new place, you don't, and remember all the business that you have to go through when that first light goes out in that first room and you're like, what the fuck? How does this flower work?
Okay.
You know?
Yes,
and you're like, so in a hotel, it's all your first day. Yeah. And you're like, what the fuck? What's this
okay.
Thing?
So that makes sense. But then you have it in your hand. Now you want to smash it.
I want to say I didn't because that seems so juvenile.
You want to say a lot of things, but
it's in my hand. How do I get it out of my hand?
You wanted to hear it smash. You wanted to see how it smashed. You wanted to see what you can get away with.
It's a new place. How do the floors work?
There's two things that cause me rage in hotel rooms. I'm in a hotel a lot because I, they do a lot of travel comedy gigs.
Humble brag.
That is a humble brag.
Some people might just be in hotels sometimes. But I'm in them
a
lot.
The TV remotes never work. You have to fight with the TV remote constantly. And then when you shut the door and you got the do not disturb, I always put the do not disturb thing on because I don't need the housekeeping to come every 5 seconds. Because if I want to come back and they're there, every time you shut the door, thing flies off. Like make it so that it stays on the doorknob.
I'm glad we talk about the real issues on this show.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We're not afraid to tackle the real shit, Hamza.
It's true. I got a little nervous as you were talking, but I'm back on board now.
As Captain Fantastic, let me tell you the greatest thing I can do with my stretchy arms. I can put on the do not disturb sign and slink right back in as it closes.
I'm not talking about that. It usually stays on when it goes back because the air sucks it back in. It's when you leave and you open the door and when it shuts, it wants to, something about the leaving.
They could come up with something better in the brainstorming sessions that they spend trying to come up with new ways of saying do not disturb.
Dumb.
I'm a lotus. Let me bloom. What the fuck are you talking about? It's like trying to figure out which is the men's room in a fucking art gallery. What do you mean, Picasso's? What is that?
Yes. I'm shingling in here.
I just pictured you looking for the bathroom. You're like, fuck it. You take your dick out and people start pointing. I don't know why. I'm sorry. Maybe it's the shingles.
What is the origin story of your friendship between you and Keith and Hemda?
We don't talk about it.
Yeah, we don't.
But it's working out, and that's what matters.
Are you friends?
Yeah, we are.
We try
friends.
To be.
I'd say we're friends.
Yes.
I mean, how long have you known each other? What's your backstory?
I think we've known each other for like 15 years now. We met at an open mic. It was a weird open mic where you got to do literally anything for 8 minutes. So we've watched someone, drink their own urine or,
Joy.
That is the weirdest.
That's
now everyone's going to wonder for the rest of their lives if this was the worst written sketch.
Right. That's what pee looks like when you have shingles.
Yeah.
Wait till you go for the eggs.
Yeah, pulled up a jug of what he's choosing to call green tea.
It says green tea.
Well, it might be green pea.
Oh, okay. I see. Sorry. That's how you met, but it's weird that I pulled up a container of urine-looking. Yeah.
One time we saw someone at that open mic.
Dripping period blood and drawing with it. Oh, he's good. He's good. That would have been a
mistake
for me.
Was that you trying to flummox him?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Okay. You can't shake him.
I see that.
When Dan gets a green tea hankering, he's...
I'm also a terrible listener.
So we'd have
So somebody drank their own pee on stage, and you thought, let's do a podcast.
Yeah. Well, he was doing stand up, and I was singing, and then I was half offended by his jokes, but I loved that he was going for it, and so I spoke to him after one of his sets. We started dating shortly after, and
don't
fist pound that. No.
Are you still?
Fuck no, bro. Fist pump.
Well, wait, how am I going to fist pump everything that happened?
Cool. It's this cool thing
so
after another.
She broke your heart, and you couldn't. And you decided to keep your phony baloney relationship alive via podcast.
Yes.
Yes. Okay. Yeah. Yeah. Actually, I think we would have broken up a year before we did, but the podcast I think kept us together.
And then you were like, wait, well, let's keep the thing that works. And
yeah. Because I was like, oh my god, I hate you for 23 hours, but then for that 1 hour of podcasting, you're super fun. But the math wasn't adding up, so we had to break up.
Right. I keep wanting to ask. I don't know how many more times I'm going to say your name, but I know you have to have this conversation every time. But I'm just curious what is your take on the how much do you prefer being put behind the CH? Like how do you say your own name?
Chemda.
You go for it, but if I do that, I feel it's
say my name.
Chemda. Like it feels like I'm doing like a character.
Say it again.
Chemda.
How does it feel now?
It felt still weird.
Go back to when you were 5.
Chemda. No, Dad. Not with the buckle end.
And now
Chemda,
say it.
Chemda.
How's it feel now?
Oh, good.
Okay.
It's like Cracker Jack and apple pie.
So I've been saying Chemda and I'm wrong. It's got a huch in it?
It's got a ugh.
Chemda. Chemda.
Yeah.
All right. You were born in Israel?
Mm-hmm.
But raised in New York since you were 4.
Yes.
Really?
This is why we broke up. He's the worst listener.
And your eyes are hazel. What you had a whole you have a whole singing thing.
I did some singing, yeah.
That's all I know is singing things. Like you have an album in addition to you've done backup on other like people's stuff?
I've collaborated with people on world music and dance music and on all kinds of different things. There's probably one of the most, I don't know which, there's, it's popular in different genres, but Conjure One, which was from Delirium, which is world music. Some people know that in the...
With Poe and Sinead O'Connor.
Oh, yeah, I was on an album with Poe and Sinead O'Connor. Can you tell I feel weird talking about this? It's like the...
She's an amazing singer.
You're talking to a man drinking urine and eating eggs out of a sack.
Yeah, no.
That's why she doesn't want to come off too pretentious.
You don't want to take it too seriously, right? Yeah. Okay.
But let's put it this way. She's been in a lot of hotel rooms. So she did pretty well.
Are you guys kind of like in your partnership as far as like your dynamic? Do you think of yourself as more the...
The will they, won't they kind, right?
No, is Chemda the does she bring in the is there a contrast? Are you like broing down and fist bumping and she's like Mother Gaia like trying to make you more likable or
yes okay. yeah she's definitely more spiritual, she's definitely deeper. She thinks people that everybody has good qualities.
He thinks that's weird. Do you think everybody has good qualities?
I think that nobody has good qualities.
I go through those phases, you know. Like I'm not in that phase right now, but when I'm down, I don't even think anyone has any good qualities. Like when I'm relatively stabilized, like or up, I feel like everybody's the hero of their own story. Like there's no such thing as a bad person.
But you think everyone's stupid.
That's me like pretty down. When I'm up, I'm like, well, what's stupid? You know, like what is that? Like who says that guy over there eating a brick is like smarter than me or dumber than me? Like maybe he's a genius at brick eating. Like I feel dumber than, you know, some people about other stuff, you know.
I do see some people talking to themselves in New York, you know, just having conversations with nobody across the street, you know, and then responding. And I go, what if they're right? What if they see something that we don't see? And what if there is a person over there?
Over time, I've become like, I can relate to them because I do a lot of talking to myself at home, and I think it's just me having fun and doing voices. But no, I'm crazy. I sing and rap and talk while I make a sandwich or take a shower.
Yes.
Like I'm only a paycheck away from being the guy on the street who's right. rapping on the street corner.
Why you wear a tie. You're trying to fool everybody.
No, my suit is the only thing holding me up.
Yeah.
Yeah, because not to be glib about it, but like if they're homeless, then that's they're going to do a couple things that you do it in your own home, like out on the sidewalk.
Right.
Yeah. But I don't think that's the real reason why someone's talking to themselves on the sidewalk. That's their singing in the shower. I think they're mentally ill, and they
project myself into a person that if I were homeless and out of work, then I would probably be a guy that was making a lot of noise out in the street. Like I for different reasons, maybe or maybe not. I don't know.
Yeah, if I wasn't worried about like, oh man, I hope someone reads my screenplay and I don't want to, once I was committed to homelessness, yeah, I'd be like talking about it a lot. I'd be like, this is great, or this sucks, or look at me, like what are you eating over there? It looks stupid. Like a nice dog. How do you know when you're finished? That kind of stuff. Like heckling.
Right.
You know who's mad about you right now is every homeless person watching you being in a comfy bed that someone brought you because
talking
of
about how I'd out homeless them. I wasn't saying I'd do it better. I saw. You know what? This is the freakiest thing I ever saw. Well, when I was like younger in Milwaukee, I was like a 20-something. Like, you know, I think about this all the time too. Even when I hear people that are like, you know. Like that I get, they're like, oh, you're so stupid, like you're fucking Nazi on Twitter or whatever. But like I remember being like I just thought all homeless people were like bums that couldn't get it, that were like oh, I don't want to get a job, so someone give me some money. Like, and I remember talking to this friend of mine, like who was a comic, and she's like doing some volunteer thing for homeless people, and I made some comment, and she's like, what the fuck is that? What are you talking about? What do you think homeless people are? And I'm like, I don't know. They're like people that don't have jobs and stuff. She's like, they're mentally ill people that don't have a support system. Like, do you know what schizophrenia is? Do you know? It just kind of like blew my mind. And like, but before that, I was still an adult and still smart and still thought that I was right about everything. And it just, it's not like she was an encyclopedia or showed me anything. It was just like one person going like, you moron, like what, you don't even know what these things are because you don't even think about them. And then when I moved to LA, one of the first things I saw that freaked me out, because in Milwaukee, all the homeless people die off like once a year. They break into everyone's cars and just die while they're trying to get warm. And like mosquitoes, on the Third Street Promenade, and there was this guy, and he basically looked like Danny Trejo. Like, he was so like prison tatted and like scary looking. Like, he just looked like you would cast him as like a no nonsense street lethal like gangster, but he was like, he was just shrieking and like crying. He was like he was crying like a baby. He was crying like somebody had taken his balloon, and he was 6 years old. And I remember thinking, oh, he's probably like 22 years old. Maybe he just started to like go, you know, like some chemical imbalance is kicking in, and he doesn't have a family that's like gonna, you know,
and
say,
what do you
hey,
do when you pass? I support you.
Exactly.
I see you.
No, exactly. It was like, you could see everybody like, what do you do? You have to treat the person like a ghost, you know, because you walk up to somebody who's like, but it's weird. It's like, they're not always just like talking to a fire hydrant. It's like the person was simply emoting. But it's funny how strict our standards are for what you're supposed to be doing and feeling, and how empathic we are. We're like, oh, that guy's not supposed to be that sad about anything. Like, nobody was looking around for his missing kid. We knew he was crazy because, and I did air quotes for the people listening, because we just knew immediately. But it's funny how like that amount of empathy results in just like, we're like insects too. Like, we just go, oh, he's a dysfunctional ant. So like, clear path. And anyways, you look like you're probably going to say something 20 minutes ago.
I'm just into it. This is so surreal. I'm like, oh, nighttime stories with Dan Harmon. I was going to say that I feel like a lot of people experience that in New York. Like, you're constantly around people, and we don't really have cars. We don't have a car, so we're riding in public all the time, and you'll have these breakdown moments, and maybe more women than men, because men's tear ducts are kind of blocked, but...
Fuck yeah, bro.
I know.
With our hard dicks.
Yes, with your very,
and
very
our
super
giant
hard
balls.
Dicks. Yeah, giant balls that you... I don't even know how you carry those things.
It's in like, our tear ducts.
Yeah, maybe... I see.
Yeah,
okay.
What a lot of women don't know is that when we're not showing our balls, they're right up in our tear ducts. Keeping
oh,
us
man.
From crying.
That clears up so much.
And when they're soft, we go to four hymns. Oh, I thought you were playing the... I thought that was ad music.
Accidentally hit my iPad with one of my balls.
Sorry, what were you saying?
So I think every woman I know has this story where she was crying on the train, and there's like different responses. Most of the time, another woman will pass you a napkin or a tissue from her purse, and that's it. That's all you get. It's like, we feel you. Now, you know, shut that shit down by the time you get to the office.
Wow.
Yeah.
I give nice. My phone number. Yeah. I'm like, for help, call. So we'll see.
Should we bring up...
When I was 10 or 11, I was in New York with my mom. We were in a subway, and like AA or whatever that one is. And there was a guy that was ranting and raving about Reaganomics and trickle down, and he was screaming at everybody. And nobody just gave him the time of day. Everyone's reading the newspaper, looking at their shit, doing their thing. And he was screaming, and pulled out a knife, like a small knife. Still, nobody gave him the time of day. Like he's not going to do anything. But the moment he walked up to my mom and started screaming, all the men stood up. They all put
nice.
Their newspaper down. Like, okay, like, you can bluster around me, but like the moment he started doing that to a
they
woman.
They took out their knives.
Yes.
We were here first.
You're never alone.
I thought that guy was going to turn out to be Alan Greenspan. Because he was raving about economics. All right, let's...
And that's why I broke the light bulb. Thank you.
Yeah.
That was a good story.
I think I maybe
Keith,
just
you
held
get
it.
Mid? You want to crawl in there? You want to make this a
Like, you ever get so drunk that like you just turn into you're just an animal. It's right before you pass out. Hopefully you're off the road, out of public, but you're just like, you have reduced yourself to nothing but cortex. I think if I did break that thing on purpose, it was because I had been, that's what I had achieved that state. I was like, just looking at it like I was on an alien planet and wanted to know how gravity worked. Like I was
did it
like
feel good. It feels like it would feel good.
I remember my emotional response to it shattering, going like, I just stood there, and then I remember going, huh. But it was more like, it wasn't about the thing, because it like did exactly what glass is supposed to do when it breaks. But I was looking at myself and going, huh.
Oh, that's what I do with my time.
Broken person. You can just drop a human being from even the height of comfort and privilege, and it'll just like, it just shatters. Like, what I pulled myself out of, like, because I have nothing to, because I had nothing to be upset about, I did this thing. I think that's why rock stars like trash hotel rooms, because it's like you can't manage all of the, everything's fine.
Oh, here's another thing that would make me want to trash a hotel room is when, I've spoken about it before, when they ornamentally put the Kleenex like in a little beautiful lotus shape, right. You know, and then you take those out because those have been handled and folded into origami by the person who presumably had been cleaning up somebody else's poop. Like, no offense to the housekeeping industry, which is a noble, wonderful profession. You take that out.
I know where the offense would have came from. And no offense, poop handlers.
But then
and we need that. And
you
we
take
need
out the lotus blossom with 5 to 12 Kleenexes, and that's all of them. And then you fucking throw it out, and you have no Kleenex now except the ones that have been origamied into sadness.
Speaking of Kleenex, let's bring to the stage, he's performed for clubs and colleges all over America, Rob Schrab.
Rob Schrab! He looks pissed off. This doesn't bode well. Hemda got out of the bed like it's like the couch at Johnny Carson, where she had to move down to the panel.
I want to give everyone a chance.
Why don't you get in bed? Get in bed, Sean.
Hello, Dan.
Hello.
Should I get into bed like Lolly gets into the bed with Kate and I?
Yeah. That's it. Does she go under the covers? Yeah. Aw, go deep, go deep. Yeah. That's Nigel. Except I find it hard to believe your dog does this.
Pretty much Rob's butt's right in Dan's face.
I really didn't do that right, did I?
No, well, that's no wrong answers. It's really hot in there, right?
He looked over at Khemda like, wow, New Yorkers are prudes.
Like Nigel does it, but the way he digs is with both front paws in unison. So he like,
oh really?
Yeah, it's kind of funny. Also, he's back to full health now because he humped the fuck out of Harvey today.
Does he know that that's not going to go anywhere? That's self-destructive.
He's not doing
behavior?
It. He's absolutely doing it when they play fetch and Harvey gets the ball. He waits for Harvey to come back with the ball, and then he humps him, and then he just finishes. He doesn't orgasm, but he finishes dominating him, and then he does this like hind leg like cat kind of burying a turd kind of move. Like he scrapes dirt, right. Phantom dirt at Harvey.
That's him spiking the football.
Yeah, he's
being
like,
alpha?
Oh, it's great, you're giant, so you get the ball whenever you want, but guess he gets to phantom fuck you.
So when you went into the doctor and he opened the door and you're sitting, you know, in the robe and everything, and you just pointed at your forehead, did it take a look at it a long time and then went, oh, you got this form of herpes, it's shingles.
No, well, first I told him about, I was like, look, I fell, but I think I also got a rash from like a New York pillowcase or something.
Is that what they call them now?
And he like zoomed in on the rash.
A New York pillowcase is when you poop on somebody's chest.
Yeah.
Right?
I guess my doctor's really good or sees a ton of people with shingles, because he was just like, I talked to him for like 10 seconds. I have, I have, I, I,
I always record my doctor sessions in case he says something that I need to remember later. And the audio file from me walking, from him walking in, not me walking in, but him walking in to see me, to me walking out the door and remembering to hit stop, 5 minutes and 7 seconds.
Ooh.
And the guy like whoa. Boom. I said a couple things about what I was thinking. I was all over the place. He's like looking at me while I was talking. He's like, you know what? Worst case scenario, shingles. Let's treat it like shingles because that's the worst. We got to treat that right away if that's what it is. If it's something else, who gives a fuck?
When did he say herpes?
He never said the word herpes. I had to find that out online.
It's post-herpetic something rather.
Right. I had the same thing. I was on a bad flight, like back from San Francisco, and it was like going over the intercom, like the stewardess was like going, "People, just sit down. Just sit down." You know, that's how bad it was. Mm-hmm. And I was just like holding on, holding my breath the entire time. And when I got off the plane, I had like this rash that grew above my eyelid. And I went to the doctor and he looked at it and he was, "Oh, you got herpes zoster.
Yeah. That's shingles."
Yeah.
I can't believe he called it that.
Yeah, but I went, "What, herpes? No, I mean, what? I mean, like, that's impossible."
Yeah, why do they give shingles such a fun name? I guess we're finding out why.
Like, yeah, but he said it like, "Oh, that's herpes," and not going. And what he should have done was, "Not the kind you think of," because that's the only kind anybody thinks of.
Right.
They don't think
kind,
of it.
Right. Is this the kind I have to say on dates?
Yeah, yeah. So, you know.
That was his moment for that day to get some excitement or something. Yeah. He needed a response.
But he didn't, like, you know, so I was like, but I didn't rub my head on a
thing that gives you the herpes, I'm
pussy.
Thinking.
And he was like, no. It's,
That's Did you wear one of the pussy hats, though?
Not one of those.
That's why they made those pussy hats.
So, Keith, Chemda, try to natural one there. Chemda.
Keith put more of a K on it.
I noticed that.
How Keith, do you do it?
Keith.
No, how do you say her name?
Chemda.
And then now you say it.
Chemda.
See, it's different. He puts more of a K.
He was born in a different place.
I'm finally getting it right. Took 13 years.
Yeah. You guys ever have a fight in all those thousands of episodes?
Yes.
I mean, like a bad one, not like it's, "Oh, this is such provocative entertainment because they disagree so much," but like you fight and it's like, shit, they're like pissed.
Yeah, yeah. What was it called? The first one that we had,
don't bring up old fights. I don't know.
he shut it off in the middle. He's like, "Well, now we're really fighting." And I was like, "But we do everything else on air, so just turn it back on and let's finish." And it actually helped because a lot of times he'll just stare at me when I'm trying to argue with him, and it's like, how boring is that? And how much, like, how
she
far
has all
can
the points anyway, you know?
Yeah, and he just really just literally stares. But if he's in front of a mic, he can't stare, so he was forced to respond to me.
Are you in new relationships now, or is this still like? Are you?
Oh no, this is like 10 years ago.
Yeah,
we
she's married now.
Oh, okay.
Yeah,
so she's moved on.
Yes.
And whereas Keith is holding on to this for dear life.
Who knows? You just live, the universe will give what the universe gives, right? This could all be the universe fucking with me.
Keith, do you think there are good and bad people?
Yeah, of course.
Like, what do you think is responsible for that? Do you think they're born good and bad, or do you think it's their they just get the luck of the draw and they're
They know better. A lot of it starts with, you know, it just is what it is. And then you take your personality whichever way you want. You realize people need help and you're here to serve, or you don't and you're selfish. I think it's that simple. I think
so we're being tested every day in big and small ways to like usually we can get by probably not like doing too much of an extreme choice, but basically there are people who are like, "You know what? It's been 3 Wednesdays in a row since Mercury's in retrograde, and I'm just gonna kill this dog with a knife," or something. Like I guess that's a bad example because that sounds like a compulsion
that
someone
like
would
a sound
have.
Example.
I feel like I missed the step.
Well, I'm trying to think of like because I don't know if I.
I think it's like being healthy. I think everybody prefers to be in shape, but they don't want to do the work.
Yes.
You know, they don't want to exercise. They don't want to eat healthy. But if they did, they would look better and probably feel better. And I think That's what it's like to be. I think when you're bad, when you're evil, you're being lazy. And when you're being good, you're actually putting some effort into life.
Yes.
I don't know. I have
we just said.
I have a problem. I mean, I don't have a problem. You guys are allowed to think that way because I'm a good person. But I just feel like then I start to like microscope that and go, well, yeah, but if I'm lazy and then I decide to start working out, like, okay, now I feel like I'm a good person because it was harder to do that than it was. But it's still what I felt like doing. I mean, I guess it gets into that whole stupid philosophical, like, free will versus fate thing. I mean, like, if my brain chemistry is going to result, are we on some synaptic level making fucking choices? Like,
it's like this. Like, if I'm, like, if Kate says, hey, let's go for a hike, I go, meh.
Like I'm there.
That's it. And then, but if I go, I'm walking and I'm having a good time and it's nice. And then I go, I'm glad I did that. I like doing that. That's fun. I always say,
what if she says
whenever she says let's go for a hike. So the next time she says let's go for a hike, I know this time I'm not going to do that noise.
But do you do it anyway?
I do it anyway.
All right.
Yeah.
I kind of like good, maybe good and bad is maybe the way I can buy into it is healthy and unhealthy. Like we all get depressed, we all get like and so or like it's like a sink full of dishes, like nobody wants to do the dishes, but like you don't. It's not like, oh, this battle of, it's just sort of like, I don't know, if somebody told you that eating a dog turd made you live another 50 years, you either eat the dog turd or you don't. And I don't think that makes you a good or a bad person, but if you eat it and they were telling the truth and you live for another 50 years, there might be all kinds of other side effects too. Like, oh, the reason for that is because there's like an enzyme in dog turds that like also like lifts your psychology, or it's like there's vitamin D in dog turds and all this stuff. So along the way, you're gaining all these benefits and you're like thinking more clearly and then you're like, well, dude, I ate dog shit the other day and I feel like $1 million. So then this homeless guy goes, hey, can I have $2? And you're like, you know what? Fuck it. Here's $2 and that Jim Carrey movie kind of thing. And you're like, so the whole time, it's like you could, I think it's like you could, that's the way I look at it, is like there's people who are in like, they're like resonating with they're like sick, and there's people who are.
So yeah, he's kind of talking about that. Keith is more black and white and I'm more gray on the show and off. So for example, a close friend of mine, we actually were roommates with each other, even with my husband. What's that?
Bill.
Johnny, you were close?
Yes.
Johnny.
Mm-hmm, you know, and He was our roommate for a little while, and we could sense that he was, the stress of life was starting to kind of skew his thinking and skew like his response to life in general and to going to work and things like that. And then we had to separate ways. We were all moving, and he got butthurt about it and spray painted the entire house. And
let me be clear how bad the spray painting was. Not only on all the walls, but like an asshole in all the corners. So when you repaint, you have to repaint the corners. Fuck you.
So it
you
didn't happen.
You've been hurt by painting before.
It's not good. I'd rather eat dog shit. I'm not exaggerating.
It makes you live long.
Mm-hmm. I'm hearing good things.
So his point was, this guy is just bad news. He's a bad person, and you know, no one should deal with him. He should be locked up for however long. And my thing is,
he should be spray painted.
His brain
in the corners
glitched, and I should stay away from him for now, but I believe that he can find another path and become a good person.
And until he does, Keith is right.
Well, I guess
it's not about that. It just is.
Yeah, I remember I've told this story before, because I broke up with a girlfriend, or she broke up with me, so I was all fucked off about it, and she was mutual friends with all my friends, and like, and then I was just handling the breakup really poorly, and I just like, I couldn't stop thinking about her and all this stuff, and I was just a drag to be around, and I found out that everybody was in Palm Springs without me, and I was like, what the fuck, you guys don't even like me now, you like her more than me and all this stuff, and I was like, it's just having this terrible day. And my friend Dino said, look, no, we love you. We just, it's not a bad, it doesn't make you a bad person if people don't want to be around you. It's like, you have a cold. It's like, you have snot dripping out of your face. Like, we can't wait for you to get better. That's it. And I was like, oh. And then I was just like, yeah, okay. So I'm sick. Like, I have a sickness called, like, I hate myself and I hate my girlfriend and I hate my friends and I hate everybody and I wish that, why can't, you know, it's like, it's just all sickness.
She,
you
had
know?
A sickness called forgetting to bring tents, water, and food to
well,
a
that's
camping
what you
trip.
Get. Don't fucking choose her.
That trip, I went to a hospital, Jesus Christ. I went to a hotel.
We heard.
Because I just didn't, I didn't trust that camping would be fun with that group of friends. And sure enough, they forgot to bring everything essential, and they all had to like go back on making fun of me for getting the hotel. And they all came and stayed at my hotel. Jerks.
What do they think a camping trip is?
They think it's bringing tents and bringing food and water, but they forgot to do all those things.
Oh.
They left it all back at home.
That sounds like the good drugs.
Yeah. And then I did acid and found myself sitting on a rock in the moonlight talking to a rattlesnake.
We were wondering if you were homeless. We were like, we'll support you.
What did the rattlesnake say?
Rattlesnake was being groovy. I'm afraid
so
of snakes. I sat on a rock and the rock was
going
talking
on,
to me.
Jeff.
Oh,
this
oh,
rock
it's a
had
Davis.
A face and it was talking to me.
Did he tell you to eat the apple?
But I kept hearing
eat
a bug going.
Eat these apples.
It's a sketch. It's a sketch.
Okay.
Jeff Davis.
You're in a thing right now.
You're in my thing.
Oh, yeah, you should totally eat the apple.
Eat my nuts.
Snakes are
is it a
nuts.
Nut tree?
Eat my nuts. Eat my balls. Eat my
fix
nuts.
The EQ
wait,
on that.
Is this the rattlesnake talking that's sitting next to me on this rock?
Eat my nuts, Dan.
Why are you calling me Dan?
Oh, sorry.
Okay. All
that's
right.
The
never
snake,
mind.
Not me.
Okay.
Oh, well, that sketch fucking didn't get off all the ground.
Right. No. I fucked up. That's why you don't plan things.
Don't plan it.
I'm afraid of snakes, and especially poisonous.
You don't like
kill you in the middle of the night. Snakes and baby snakes are gonna bite you first because they're not trained to like kind of keep it cool.
And they eat you from the toes up. So they
the snake is not gonna eat me from
the
toes up.
They eat you from. Did you see that elephant that got eaten?
I think you're dead by the time it starts eating you, though.
That's how they do it. That's okay. How they get you.
Yeah. So
start
okay.
With the toes.
So I kept hearing.
So you can't
a,
run
I
away.
I kept hearing the buzzing of bugs and zzzz. Oh, the bugs and the rock is talking to me, and I look over and now it's a rattlesnake, a little baby rattlesnake. It's sitting right next to me. I'm like, hey, little buddy, I'm like you should move on. And Mark Rivers comes up with a big floodlight. And he goes, Jeff. Get the fuck out of there. Like, hey, man, I'm fucking high. Like, I was grooving. I was groovetastic with a rattlesnake. Next day, was not on acid, and duct taped my pants around my boots because there were snakes all over the goddamn joint.
All right. I got one.
So you guys brought duct tape but not a tent. Just wondering.
I came quite
there's
prepared.
A lot of ducks out in the desert. A lot of people don't know that.
And that you can make tape out of them.
The desert ducks are dangerous, the most dangerous.
The worst.
Because they're like, how the fuck did I end up out here where I can't even use a third of my abilities?
I can't even use a third of my abilities.
Sketch idea, duck, desert, and...
God
and
damn it, I'm an all-terrain chicken. What am I doing in the one place where I can't rub that in the chicken's face? All right, come on. Here's the one thing.
Wait, how handsome is Jeff?
Yeah, it's too much.
He's good looking. It's you know, but
let's move on.
No, let's keep
let's
talking
move
about
on.
It.
I got we'll my do the whole show about how good looking Jeff is.
Demorge, you were asleep for a while there, were you not?
Whoa, Jesus Christ.
Demorge had passed out.
Spencer's here.
Hey, also, guys. Congratulations on Arsenal.
Like, I'm curious, do you grow out your hair and wear your pajamas? And it's like, you can't even get close to comparing me to Jeff, because obviously.
Yeah, I mean, that's my only hope.
I'm not even
hope.
Trying to make it a contest.
Exactly.
He's a beautiful man.
I just
was a beautiful child.
Stay under Jeff's bridge and charge a toll for whoever comes over it. There's one thing, now that my nervous system is jacked up, I was going to save this for a non-shingles, but now I can feel the herpes coursing through my fibers. I just wanted to bring up one thing and get to the bottom of it. Venetian blinds, what the fuck... Like, what is the fucking rule with what direction to pull the fucking string in?
around the neck.
To make him stay. Are you supposed to pull him to the left or the right?
You pull him inward at a diagonal angle to have them go up and down, right?
And then stay?
And then you pull it straight down for them to stop.
It's like a hand job, kind of.
What if I want to pull my Venetian blinds up halfway and lock them in place halfway? What am I doing?
Yeah, so you pull diagonal until it's about halfway, and then you would then
swivel over.
Yeah, and then bring it, wheel it down so it's vertical.
What the fuck is up with this backboard? Look at this shit. I get three sticks.
He's got three sticks.
No wonder my back hurts.
For the
folks
at home,
piece of
the bed frame has three sticks and a large hole for a pillow to fall through.
It hurt.
They just assume we've got a wall.
I used the fact that I was hot to get out of there because it was
fucking
killing me.
He said he was hot, but it was really the three sticks.
Oh, my God.
I did my homework.
Like, why is that even an option? Do you want a backboard? How about just the frame?
How about not any of a backboard?
Just the frame. We've got to set this thing up before the show, and putting the whole backboard up is going to take some time.
Grown-ass adults, we're finally tackling the intricacies of Venetian blinds and IKEA headboards.
Do you know how to work the fucking blinds when you want to make them, like, how about this? Here, forget about how to lift them up and make them lock, because that's easy. Suppose they're halfway up, and what you want to do is very quickly, because you got other things on your mind. There's a reason you're going to close the blinds. How do you release them and they go all the way down without stopping a quarter of the way down?
You pull them at a diagonal, keep it up a diagonal slightly.
Give them some slack.
You got to get after you do the diagonal. You got to get a little lube.
Schrab is about to play
to play
a dream date.
Pull, you know, get some hymns.
I think Ken's the cutest. I think Ken's
diagonal.
It's not intuitive, but once you get it down, you're like, holy shit, am I a wizard?
If you look at the little sprocket up there when you're doing it, it makes sense.
When you look at it, it does not make sense. It just looks confusing as fuck.
Well, I'm an engineer.
Yeah,
so
no, Jeff's a genius, and I'm sure he understands it. Don't get me wrong.
I come from a long line of levelers.
And gnomes.
Yes. We changed our name to Davis during World War II because Level Earth were also hoarding Nazi gold.
Are you an outdoorsman, Keith?
No. I can play along for a little bit. I do enjoy camping because you're doing nothing. But no, here in L.A., Khemda keeps running Runyon Canyon and trying to get me to go. And I go,
caught one of the conversations you were having. It caught a little piece of you talking about the landmark.
Mind your fucking business.
Did you really go to the landmark forum?
Landmark is this. It's a group setting. It's a therapy, but group therapy. So, and I do not believe these guys can do one-on-one therapy. But my ex-wife, when she left me and Landmark pushed her to do it, she paid for me to go too. So right. I thought that was sweet.
No, I've had that, but I've never gone because it just seems like you know, yeah.
You get your two or three lessons. You could have got anywhere else. It's upwards of $1,000. And then other lessons they throw in are how to stand up for yourself. And they have us do an example. And in this example, I will say to you, why don't you come to a Landmark seminar, and you tell me no.
Right.
And then I will keep trying to convince you, and you keep saying no.
Until you've given me $1,000.
Yeah. Yeah. Right. And that is you standing up for yourself.
Jeez. I remember a friend, I've had several friends who have told me about it, and then I go I remember one of them said, oh, I do this Landmark thing. And I said, is that a cult? And you know, the tea hadn't, cult hadn't come out of my mouth. And she, without anger, like a well-trained, aquarium creature that saw a glint of a herring spoon and knows exactly which hoops to jump through. It was like, well, do you know what a cult is? The definition of a cult is the following things. And she ran through the entire definition of a cult. And I was like, can I add one thing, which is that you have a rehearsed speech about whether you're a cult?
Cause I think it's in their FAQs.
Well, our guy, no joke, the guy leading the thing is like, people are going to ask you, is it a cult? And I'm like, all right, let me hear how you answer that. Well, then that's a cult I want to be a part of. Am I right? And of course, everybody wants to fit in. And they start chanting.
I mean, we are totally unfair to cult. Cult is like the word hipster in terms of religion. Like we just use it for things that we don't like. I mean, we just like, oh, it's creepy or it's weird or we don't like it. Like I'll tell you the definition later, because you could be a Mormon and talk about someone else's religion as if it's a cult.
I remember when I was in like senior year of high school, and I was like gonna go to Madison. We're gonna drive up to Madison, and my parents are like, why are you going to Madison? And it's like, oh, I'm gonna go see this this cult movie at midnight. It's gonna be cool. And they sat me down, and they gave me this lecture about like how cults are bad and that it's against Jesus Christ, and we're really, really we really are concerned about what you're going to do, why you want to see this. I'm going to see the Toxic Avenger. What the fuck? Are you serious? Dave and Donna? That's what you think? I'm going to go see the Toxic fucking Avenger at midnight at Madison, and you're worried about my immortal soul.
Close
go
my
see
door,
a
Mom.
Cult movie.
Well, they had been...
Death Race 2000.
Did you go?
Fuck yeah, I went, man.
Did you join the
fuck
cult?
Fuck yeah, I bought the t-shirt and drank the Kool-Aid,
there it
man.
Is. Did you buy the sneakers?
Kate and I have been going to a Buddhist temple. it's been quite good.
How do you like it?
Are you meditating and chanting?
Yeah, it's great. Yeah.
Are you Zen?
Yeah. Yeah, it's doing going good.
Is that why you shaved recently?
What's that?
Like to fit in with the monks?
No, I'm bald.
I know, but it looks good.
Thank you.
It's like you freshen it up.
I freshened it up.
How regularly do you go?
Huh?
How regularly do you go?
Oh, that's a good question.
I've only gone once. Okay. But, so
you're chill as
every
fuck.
Every last Monday.
Okay.
So they haven't done the thing yet where the Buddhist monk comes out and he goes like, now listen, that was all free, but for the next hour, I want you to go out to the phones. I want you to call 5 people. For every 5 people, you get into Buddhism. You come back.
That actually didn't happen. That's not what they did. But the guy, the leader, the whatever, the president that sits in the front?
The president?
What's the guy?
The president.
The Buddha?
No.
That's so easy to remember.
The Buddhist priest?
Dale Buddha.
No. He's kind of like a Jim Carrey type. You know, he would like, oh, so we do.
Jim Carrey.
We do this.
Namaste.
We do this. A little bit. Like, he would be like, so does anybody have any questions?
Wait.
Oh, my God.
He was Paul Lind?
It's 9/11.
What's happening?
Is it 9/11? We have an alarm going off at 9/11. Yes.
It's every time you look, isn't it?
It's Steve too late.
It's
going
actually
off at
11/6.
Steve Levy, you think of everything.
Not in front of the New Yorkers.
We celebrate.
It's a big joke to us out here.
Wow. We give all the shingles. We do all the 9/11s. Okay.
Hey, let me ask you guys this.
Do you want to give this new bed some bugs?
Oh, right.
Right.
I told my landlord once, I'm like, I'm very sure that I saw one bed bug. And he's like, oh, okay. Do you think I should call somebody? I'm like, it's your place. It's the end. I'm like, it's your place.
Should I call one exterminator?
So Keith and Chemda.
Thank you.
That was the what at this point, do we podcast for other people or for ourselves? Why do you keep doing it since you've been doing it longer?
We're changing the world a little bit each time. We'll be done in 2.5 years.
Oh.
Yeah. We both. Both. We. There's obviously...
But we're probably just egomaniacs and haven't figured it out. And as soon as we do, we'll stop.
There's an urge to do it. And also, it pays our bills. But, you know, obviously getting in letters about... That sound almost like we saved a person's life. That's beyond thrilling.
So you're saying it's possible to do a podcast for years and years and make money at it?
Yes.
Wait a second.
Well,
we might need to look at this.
I mean, now that we're on Starburns, we're rich. Huh?
Wait a second.
We'll be talking. What about maybe, I mean.
All I've gotten is underwear out of this.
And
me
socks.
Rich in underwear.
Huh?
And me socks.
I don't have any me socks.
And Blue Apron.
Blue Apron never gave me fucking anything.
Well, that's because he didn't ask. Because
now
they would if you wanted.
For a boner pill company. I don't need a boner pill company.
That's
but
not
I have a full
you're up your eyeballs in boner
dick
pills.
Dick works, and I'm fucking shilling for
prove
this.
It. Prove.
Jeff, four hymns isn't about making your dick work. It's about making sure your dick doesn't stop working.
That's do you think it could fit under this bed?
Yes.
Yeah, no, definitely. I was right. Oh, no.
What happened at work today, sweetheart?
What do you guys do?
What if he broke the bed and hurt himself really
don't
bad?
Don't kill yourself, Tanner.
It's not like... They're not a sturdy frame.
This is the opposite of stage diving.
Now that you guys have a guest-driven podcast, like, yes. what do you have any pointers on, like, like how to do good interviews or
Shrabby, okay.
like, is there anything to when you're, but is it?
I think it's about being present, and you don't want distractions going on, perhaps,
right.
So that you can have a real connection with the guest.
Because it's like the word
focus.
Guest is like. They're your guests. Like, you want to treat them
with respect and know that
know
you know
this.
You're there.
And they're going to make your show. They're there for you.
They're there for you as much as they are for them.
Yeah. So just do unto others.
Yes.
Dot, dot, dot.
Just show that you care and that you respected their time.
Right.
Who is your favorite guest that you guys have ever had?
We had a guest that just sat in a chair and was normal. That was a good time.
That sounds really fun. How did that go?
It went very well because then you can get to know them. They share what's happening on in their lives. You're saying something that you can relate to. And you actually leave there. Everybody learned something.
Leave me out of it.
Right.
And leave
no
me out of it. You
should
be ashamed
being.
Of yourself.
You're probably
you're
cementing and
70
forming
years old.
New
Stop
relationships.
It.
You're forming new bonds.
You're forming new
with
bonds.
With people. And
right.
I think that's the excitement. And even after doing this for over 13 years, you still learn from each person.
You learn
really
from new
that.
People. When you open yourself up to new people, you yeah. can really learn a lot that you couldn't otherwise yeah. if you close yourself off.
Yeah, and I'm not saying 44 is old, but even at 44, you think, all right, did I meet every different kind of person? And when you get people to open up, you really didn't.
So right. you're my age.
What?
You're my age. You're actually, so that means you've been doing this for so long.
I'm not your age. I knew your age, and I wanted to get you to say it.
Oh.
I'm 32.
Oh, Rob, Jesus.
No, I'm 44.
Oh, because you would have been eight when you. All right.
Now, Dan.
Yeah.
Are we worried about your drinking?
I don't know.
Okay.
I mean,
I did all I can.
Go ahead. Worry away if that's
you
what
fought,
gets you
guys,
drunk.
You fought like a lion king.
Everybody's got their own medicine. For a lot of people, worrying about my drinking seems to get them through the day. I got my own methods.
How's he doing under there?
He's making some headway.
Literally.
I don't want to check with him about what his goals were. I remember him saying, "Do you think I can get under the bed?"
I think I got under.
Yeah, he's yay. Definitely under.
I got
yes.
under the bed.
You did it.
Well, whoever uses the space.
I don't think I can get out though. I don't think I can get out of the
bed. Well, that's
yeah,
that. You should
I
have thought
I'm
of that
stuck.
Before you tried to go under the bed, Shrap.
Oh, I think I'm stuck poo. Under the bed now.
That might be okay.
Did you find the honey?
No.
Is there honey under there?
I think
is
I found the honey.
To
Winnie the Pooh.
Oh, okay. Is Winnie the Pooh's...
He's notoriously stuck under
oh,
beds.
He gets, oh, yeah. He gets stuck in his little tuchus is sticking out of the...
Yeah.
the
and then
the,
somebody puts a vodka bottle up his butt. It's yeah. like the same thing.
Everyone's having a good
time.
You read
the whole book.
I didn't think that was funny.
You did.
Right, yeah.
You loved
it. A different time.
I'm pretty sure it was funny.
Look no. at what you were wearing. Gross.
Right.
You were asking
you
for
that's
it.
You wouldn't have worn those shorts point. If you didn't want a giant Kettle One bottle up your butt.
You don't know that.
I just found out that my favorite children's book is, there's a live adaptation of it happening somewhere in the area.
Avengers?
Rancho Cucamuca. What's it called?
Cucamonga.
Yeah.
Ricky Ticky Tavi.
No, that's not my favorite.
The Pokey Little Puppy?
Nope, that's
okay.
not it.
Okay. Right.
Dr. Butt?
C-Spot nope. Run.
Nope. My favorite is the hard-to-get turtle. No, I guess that was a, yeah.
I love that one.
With
all those animals?
with all those turtles
and colors,
hard to get,
and word problems,
and Cat word problems. Hat.
My favorite is Frederick by Leo Leone.
Boo. Oh, God.
You can't boo a children's Overwrought. Book, but you don't even.
Jesus Christ.
That is a turgid piece of shit.
That's a pretentious kid's book.
It's a little.
My mom hated The Hungry, Hungry Caterpillar, and she used to talk to other moms that were like, my son's reading The Hungry, Hungry Caterpillar, and she's like, fucking hipsters.
I
thought it was a good book, but, you know, whatever.
I liked There's a Monster at the End of This Book.
Oh, yeah. And it was you all along.
No, it was Grover.
Oh, I thought it was a mirror.
Yeah, it was a mirror. Did you get, like, a used book? And
someone drew just drew it. Grover.
His mom was a cheapy peepee,
well,
too.
Maybe the back hey, of the page.
Hey,
his
hey,
mom is not
hey,
a cheapy
hey,
peepee.
Hey, hey.
Now that
hey,
he's trapped
you.
Under the bed, let's make fun of him
hey,
mercilessly.
Fuck you.
He's a cheap.
Hey, fuck
this is
you.
Perfect.
Hey, fuck you, Dan. You get under this bed.
Was Pee-Pee her maiden name, or did she
you
marry into the Pee-Pee
family?
You go
under that bed and say that to him.
Get under, yeah.
Pee-Pee Longstocking?
Pee-Pee Long, cheapy Pee-Pee
you don't get
Longstocking.
Them, Annette. No, this isn't your issue.
No kids, Chemda?
No, thank you. That's
oh,
too
yeah.
much.
I don't think he was
like
offering. I think
too much like don't want to bring him into this world, or too much like responsibility. Like I still have to be a baby.
I can't even believe that I'm in my 40s. I still want somebody to make me dinner and do the things. So I don't know why I would get up. And also, my brothers both had kids, and they both said it's so much more work than we thought. And I was like, that's all Mom and Dad talked about. That we were just a big pain yeah. in the ass.
Only there was a book on it.
Yeah. I like being a lazy uncle. You know, yeah. you get to buy impractical gifts, and you don't have to fucking hang out. I've never changed a poopy poops.
I changed the diaper.
You did the poops?
Yeah.
Yeah, well, you're a better person.
Well,
there's good people, there's bad people, right?
I'm a bad person. I don't want the poops or the peas or the thing.
You should probably wait until you have an uncontrollable, like, oh, my God, I got to have one, and not that other feeling, which is like, oh, I bet they're great.
Yeah. I think I got that because I was they were teaching me to want that. So, like, at 18, I felt my clock ticking. But then when I turned 30, I was like, oh, everything they said was bullshit. And then I just went about my day. Mm. It was great. What a revelation to realize that.
Seems like a nightmare.
So many lies.
Yeah, you got to fucking hang out with them all the time. And what if they're a dick?
Yeah. I mean, you don't even know for years. And then it's, like, too late to take it back. It's, like, crazy.
There's
like,
no way. Yeah,
what if you have a bad kid?
There's no way that I would have a child and the child be just mellow.
Right.
And then they blame you.
Yeah, and I would they would be right, and I would want to not hang out with him.
He's
yeah.
always wearing a suit. Jeff's kid.
That's
always
my
hanging
thing.
Around the bar. It's like, this guy's cramping my style.
He's trying to wear my suits. I'm like, you're not fucking tall enough for that shit.
Yeah. You can't.
Yeah, I mean, like,
off.
I'll be into Minecraft pretty heavily, and then I'll be like thinking about the dog needing to go out, and I'm kind of like, you know, it's an animal. I can hold it, you know? And I'm like, if you had a kid, you never, no way, right? But then I think about, you know, making a little Cody.
You got the name?
Oh, no. My girlfriend's name is Cody. And you know.
But you're not going to get little Cody. You're going to get a giant Dan.
That's always the trick.
You're
going to
get a gross half Cody, half fucking horrible shit monster. Yeah.
Everyone wants a girl.
Yeah, that's
true.
You
got to make sure you get a girl.
Yeah, but
if you
get
a girl,
you have to like think about every true crime podcast you've heard. And if you have a guy, you can just be like, where are you going? Oh, no. All right, fine.
You want me to tell you a rape story I read today?
What's that?
A rape story I read today?
Oh, please.
Yes, please. The least we can provide you with as a guest, please, have a rape corner. you can have your own segment here.
It's deadly.
What's the latest one that you...
Some rape corner music here. Let's do rape.
I'm sure this will be good.
I didn't really mean it. All right, girl's 12 years old, goes to school, thinks it's just
welcome
normal.
To Keith Malley's Rape Corner.
Sorry. He was, all right, okay.
How to make things funny when they're really, really not. The Keith Malley story, rape is really hot. Go!
So this kid thinks he has a relationship with his teacher because he's very mature. But no, the teacher's just using him and invites him over to his house and has sex with a child.
Keith Malley, oh, Keith Malley.
That really happened.
Probably.
How about that Golden State
Which
killer?
Which one of those characters was you, Keith?
Don't worry, it happened.
Do you guys not care about the Golden State killer getting caught because you're in the Eagle State?
We're still crying about 9/11, too busy not forgetting.
What's the?
You guys moved on quick.
That was like
no, we never forget. We set the alarm.
That was 11 minutes ago, Keith. Get over it.
I think that alarm was to show off.
I'm having a hard time breathing.
Do you want someone to pull you out by the feet, Rob?
No, no, no. Do not do that.
If New York is the golden state, is that the motto?
Do you want me to get out the vodka bottle?
What is that, the nickname?
We've never said it to each other.
And what's the New York equivalent of the golden state?
The Big Apple.
No, that's the city.
The fruit salad. The whole state is fruit salad. We're the Big Apple.
I don't. I can't stay mad at you.
The fruit basket.
Yeah, I don't. I feel bad. I don't know.
All right.
The Empire State. The Empire State, right?
Oh, the Empire State.
Yeah.
Jeff, I totally got credit for that.
That was amazing that you had that trivia, Hemda.
Thank you.
How did you think of that? That's a crazy.
Sometimes it comes to you. It's like when you've been podcasting this long.
Right. It's just experience.
Yeah.
We don't have that.
It's like a light bulb, but then you don't throw it on the ground and let it chatter.
Right. It's like a light bulb that you hold.
Oh, have you gone back to Israel since you were four?
I have, yeah. We used to go a lot every summer, every other summer. And then like 10 years ago, my parents moved back. I went a couple times, but we no longer speak. So
you don't speak to your parents anymore?
I can't tell if I don't speak to them or if they don't speak to me, but we're not speaking.
Wow.
Yeah.
It just kind of like fell apart.
That's like you, Dan, and your folks.
Well, I speak to my folks, but I could see. I mean, I don't want my parents to hear me say I could see, but it's not held together with the kind of.
But you don't talk to your brother anymore,
right?
You have a niece that you don't know.
I have a niece I've never met. It's like
Sesame Street bullshit going on.
Why don't you talk to your brother anymore?
My brother got. I talk shit about him on the podcast.
What'd you say? What'd you say about him?
I implied that there was a strange kind of thing when I was growing up between him and my mom. I was trying to be more glib than anything, you know.
I don't see what the big deal about that is. That sounds like fine.
But I felt after I did it, you know, I was like, oh shit, my brother. I don't want my brother to hear that. I don't want my brother to stumble onto this by himself, you know. Like so, even though it sucks to like turn him onto it because it could just. Get away with it. It would be so much worse if he just wandered into it that I have to.
It's hard to guess that though, because maybe it's only telling him it must be so bad if you felt you had to give it to him.
Yeah, exactly. But at that point, it's kind of like it was the only right thing to do after the wrong I had done. It was just like, you probably shouldn't talk about other people. You should try not to. I mean,
was it real?
It was. Like, that's why he was so mad.
Well, I mean,
it wasn't.
It was subjective.
I was sharing a subjective like kind of feeling. I was just like, my mom and my brother had like an intense, more intense relationship than me and my mom had. And I was like in front of a crowd, so I kind of like, you know, I just said like. I don't know. I like being like I don't like talking about my family
like
anymore.
You were asked to go running or something just there for a second.
I've been doing this for so long that now I've gone through phases, and one of them is like I just try to avoid talking about anybody but myself as much as I can. But back then I didn't really have any kind of rules. I was still coming from a zone of like, you know what, whatever the fuck, you know, if you encountered me in your life, then you're part of my fucking tapestry. Right. And so when I heard it afterwards, and I was like, I better email my brother so that even
that
though
was
it's going to suck. And then I emailed him,
here's the problem. The email is, do you think you should listen to it? I don't think it's too much. It's probably silly, but you should. Anyway, I'm definitely going to keep it in my show.
Oh, yeah. Well, I'm not going to
fucking. With full respect, your brother.
Yeah, because it's not like I gave his address and like said, go talk to him about it. It's just like, I mean, it was.
Just implied you have sex with mom.
It was.
I'd be more alarmed that someone referred to me as my own chosen nickname, Darth Vader.
Well, yeah, I mean, I think it was all in there. I think I kind of did a run where I was like, let me tell you about my brother. And then so I heard it and I was like, I better tip him off that I clowned him if I want to try to salvage anything, because he might get mad. He might not, though. He might be like, whatever, you fucking turd. He must have listened to it, and then he emailed me back and he was like, he was just like kind of inconsolable about it. I probably also wasn't very good at resolving that kind of thing back then. So I that's why I don't talk to him.
It
also kind of coincided with him having the kid that I've never met, because, and I think it was in some respects, what he said sounded healthy to me, which is like, oh, I just had a kid. I'm sick of this family. like I have a chance at a fresh start here, which is something that my therapist constantly echoes too. She's like, you don't have to, don't let people tell you that you have to, like, you know, have this connection to these Walton Mountains that you grew up on, you know, like that sometimes, like, just let them be, you know, like, thanks. Like you got to find your own thing. And like, so, and my brother was like, yeah, it's my chance to start my own thing and like start it fresh. And like, my daughter will never know this weird
my
family.
My brothers.
right. She'll never know her uncle.
This is uncomfortable, but I hope okay. Let's bring him out.
Bones, Harmon.
How old, out of the bed.
How old is your nephew that you've never met, Harmon?
Niece,
sorry.
I don't know. I think over 10. Oh,
wow. And you've never spoken to her? Never?
Any drive-bys?
Take a peek? No.
Start crying?
No, I think my mom sent me a couple pictures.
When's the last time you cried?
Really recently. Like, I cried in therapy. I cried at Coco.
Do you ever cry happy? Like, just like to see some beautiful weather or something like that?
Well, I guess Coco is kind of a happy cry, right? You're crying because you're happy for the Mexican people. They're happy they're dead or whatever.
Mm, well, I think you missed the point, but yeah.
Wait, I haven't seen Coco, so don't spoil it for me. But
assume he's wrong.
No, you're supposed to be happy for the dead Mexican people. It sounds bad when you say it, but it's the truth of the movie. Is you're crying with happiness for the dead Mexican people.
Okay, I want to come out now. I want to.
Well, should have thought of that.
I think if those characters were here, they'd say, well,
how
we're
you
more than Mexican.
Do you
want
to back it up, Rob,
you know,
or do you want us to lift the bed for you?
It was a very Mexican movie, which also made it good.
Rob, you only have a half hour of show left. You can tough it out.
Yeah, you got this.
So my face is starting to hurt.
Oh, that's shingles.
You might have shingles.
Is it just one side?
Well, it's the one I'm resting my weight on.
Are you dusting? Are you snorting dust under
are
there?
Are you dusting, yeah. Hoffman?
Let me ask you this, rookie to pro. Podcasting. Oh, yeah, how do you find good. An ending? You know, like what if you get caught in a rut where your show is apparently 2 hours long? What, do you keep making it 2 hours? I have this fantasy where I keep like well, I roll it back 5 minutes.
Yeah, why can't you do that?
I don't know.
We could do that.
I guess the same reason why it became 2 hours, because I don't know. Well, I don't
I
know.
Could
what,
end
in
it
a
right
vacuum,
now.
How do you
I
end?
Could just say the magic words, and we could just.
Well, that we couldn't do.
That feels awkward to me.
That's literally not possible.
I think what we need, we don't need it now because we don't, you know, pretty soon we'll be in front of an audience again and we'll.
Do you miss that?
Yeah. Of course. You know.
Yeah, so what's the status now? I've been away for a while. What's going on with the audience thing?
We're getting one back.
We're gonna be doing a residency at a theater.
Is that the one downtownish?
Yeah.
Are you fucking under
are
there?
Are we allowed
what's
to
happening?
Mention anything?
Kinda.
Or no?
Yeah, go ahead.
Maybe. I wouldn't.
We're reversing the trope of the guy under the bed having to hide while the people on top are doing it. There's a guy under my bed doing it.
You know, you're going to believe any kids now that say there's monsters under the bed.
Yeah.
It's Rob, are you strong. Thinking it was a good idea or a bad idea to go under there?
He's happy.
Oh, he's coming. Hold on.
Okay.
He's finishing.
I think it might be I don't think it's a good idea.
Yeah.
It's
a great
he's
idea.
The option ever comes up. Just don't assume that you should. He wants everybody to know.
I think you should feel accomplished. You said, I wonder if I can get under the bed, and now
he's under.
You don't have to wonder anymore.
I wanted to come out, but then Jeff started sticking that thing in my ass.
So you want to stay there longer so he can keep doing it?
No.
I guess he wanted to... Yeah, hide under the bed.
I don't know, Chemda. I'm getting a mom vibe here.
From the New York Squares.
You would make a great mom.
Thanks, buddy.
Well, of course.
I think anyone who says they don't want to be a mom would make a great mom.
I agree.
Is that, do you, you're saying that you're being sarcastic because that's what everybody says, right?
Yeah.
Like we all jump on the women that say they don't want to be, not literally jump on them, but the like we act like they're
yeah,
refusing
like
the call.
You would be a good mother. Yeah, you would
I
be.
Do get annoyed when I say, I don't want to hold your baby. And people, there's like, that's like a guy thing, I think, like because everybody thinks it's like a trope where like, oh, you're going to hold the baby and then you're going to turn into like a dad that wants a baby. And
you're gonna look like Sam
like
Neill from the end of
Jurassic Park when he's got the two sleepy kids on him and Laura Dern.
Yeah, like I don't want to answer John Cusack in Point Blank, Gross Point Blank. Like that's not gonna happen all the time. And that's not me saying I hate your baby or I hate babies. I'm just saying like I don't want to hold your baby. Like just because you need your baby held at this particular time because you want to experience a brief taste of what it's like to be a normal human for a couple seconds. That's not gonna just sync up with me wanting to hold a baby.
No, I warn people that I'm not good at holding babies, and they keep insisting. And on the third time, I run with the baby.
Yeah. I just realized if people would just characterize it as what it is, which is a favor, if they would go, would you mind holding this baby? Like is what you do with a bowling ball full of hornets. Do you mind so I can get a drink so I can retaste my youth? No, I will do that favor as a friend because you've done shit for me. But they're always like, you want to hold them? Right. You want to hold them, don't
they
you?
Add to it. You're doing them the favor, yeah. And you have to be begging for the favor.
Oh, thanks for giving this chalice of fucking magic. Yeah. I know I'm sitting here pretending like I'm a curmudgeon. Yeah.
I think Rob took the hymns, sound? And now he's acting up.
There's a ripping sound.
That's a tendon, I think. I'm actually so old now that it's been 8 years since anyone's made me hold a baby. It's not even I'm at a party where there's fertile people running around, you know, like all of my friends' kids are in college.
Have you ever been given the ultimatum? Have a baby or we're breaking up?
No.
Rob, you want me to get the kettle out so we can scoot you along here?
Should we all grab one side and just see who's stronger?
Cody and I are up in the air. I think we made a decision. Like, let's be the couple that doesn't know if they're gonna have a kid, you know. And like we like that. It's like, why do I have a favorite color? What does
what
that
are
mean?
These legs is,
what if I say my favorite color is orange? Does everything have to be orange?
Is slipping.
What's your favorite movie? It doesn't make any sense.
Right, it doesn't. But do you have a favorite color?
This middle leg.
No,
this middle
I don't.
Bed leg is slipping.
Of what? A T-shirt.
Of a T-shirt.
Burgundy.
See?
Oh, good one. What if Rob is dying and we're just...
It's squishing my hand.
Can you imagine? I picture Dan being a kid, though, and them asking the elementary school class, like, what is your favorite color? What is it? What is a favorite color? Yeah. Now everything's that color.
I wish I could go back and be that kid. I think I was that kid in ways that I didn't understand I was being that kid. Right. But I want to go back and taste being that kid and, like, actually draw a line in the fucking sand and go, fuck you, stop tickling me, you know? Right. You know, that's a thing now, like, non-consensual tickling. Yeah. Like, you... I'm watching my girlfriend's sister and they're raising their kids and they're like they're doing all the like those kids have never been hit, they've never been like they're it's all the tropes that you would roll your eyes at for modern parenting, you know, but they're great kids, they're totally like happy and healthy, and they like the boy is 2 years older than the girl and he like loves her and like hugs her and says I love my sister and stuff. And
they give them a thought process instead of telling them what to do.
Yeah, like they engage with them like in a way that I'm like, when I first was watching them do it, I was like, don't you know that kid is fucking manipulating you? Like, teach him who's the fucking boss, you know? Like in the back of my head, I was just like, don't let that piece of shit run your life.
It's just you and the kid, you lean over, you don't have me.
Hey, Dan.
Yeah?
You want to have a fun exercise or you stand up real quick?
Oh, sure. Okay.
Yeah, we're worried about Rob thrashing under the bed might have caused the bed to become unstable.
He seems so resilient.
Some of the middle structure legs are kind of warping to the side. I don't want him to get smashed.
Are you kidding? On IKEA furniture?
That would
Come
be
on.
A fucking crazy way for Rob to have died.
It would be very fitting, I think.
It would be a horrible way for him to die, but it would be the best way for your friend to have died. Like, oh, how'd your friend die? I crushed him.
I crushed him. How you doing?
Okay.
Hey, Dan, it's not really my place to say this, but...
We had three endings that we passed. In answer to your question.
Yeah.
I never let a guest make you get out of bed.
No, okay. See?
This is good.
How are you?
Everything just changed.
I wish I knew these tips. Yeah. Well, I mean, he's the game master. He's not really a guest. He's like kind of a permanent resident.
I'd like to think of myself as a guest.
because it gives me more clout.
I meant the gentleman actually under your bed, but I see what you're saying.
Oh, I think of Rob as a guest.
I don't even know what he is. He is
the Hamburglar.
He's a ward of the podcast.
I just started showing up and they felt sorry for me.
All right. Well, I think the answer to my own question is there's a little bit of format needed so that you know we were playing D&D and we'd know, okay, well then we're going to end the show with D&D, but you know, it's...
You miss that, Spencer? Those were the days, right?
Oh, yeah. I mean, yeah. I'm a really structure-driven person, so I just crave it. I'm like a vine. I need one of those trellises. Otherwise, I'll just trip everybody.
Do you ever bring a D&D game that you wrote anyway, even though he says we don't do that anymore? Even though he says we don't do Shadowrun anymore?
Yeah, I actually, yeah. I still bring, I bring a session for every game we've abandoned. And I bring a balderdash. It's good, but it doesn't often come up. But I like to be prepared.
You're 17 episodes into your NPR remote piece about the getting the permits.
Oh yeah, yeah. No, I've done all that stuff. We didn't play a single one of those.
I think I'm gonna
prepare. Well, we do 2 hours, so I prepare 6 hours for every show we do. Most of it doesn't matter, but I do commit.
Does that bother you at all? Because you do all that, and Dan went out and bought some eggs.
Yeah, no, well, I did buy those eggs.
And you got the eggs, too.
It was part of it. He was like, we're going to need some eggs on the show. No, I love it. I appreciate it. I like not having to do the work that I did.
Right. Does anything bother you about the whole setup? You can say no.
I think the bed's a little loud.
Right.
It's a bit garish.
Like color-wise or
I like muted colors.
I think it
colors.
Needs like an inch muted more palettes. Underneath.
I could have used it to be like three times ricketier.
If you go down there and look at the three little posts that are holding up the center of this bed, it's not structurally
Yeah, you'd think a grown man was thrashing around while someone was like laying on it.
It looks really shaky. I was really worried that Rob was actually just going to get demolished.
Well, he was warping it pretty intensely while he was under it.
Do you guys want to play high low?
Oh, what's that?
Wait.
That's where.
How do you play that?
It's like red. Is red light, green light?
Sure, but sure. Different.
Yeah.
Well, how do you play it?
Okay, you say.
Isn't that funny? Because I will not agree to it until I know how to play it. First, take your dick out. I'm glad I said.
Yeah, this is right.
What's the rules?
See, I knew it.
The simplest version is you say the high of the day and your low of the day. We expanded a little to say what the lesson is of the low and what you're grateful for, but we can start with just high, low. What's the high of the day? What's the low of the day?
That sounds like a show closer. I like that.
I think the high of the day for me was Rob being hilarious and under the bed.
And what was your low?
What was my low? I've just been kind of in a... like, I can't turn on the news kind of depression. Mm-hmm. And so watching Twitter freak out about Michelle Wolf,
yeah.
You know, and all that stuff. And
feeling the pressure that you have to catch up with it.
What is it? Does that? It's like, oh, come on. Like, we have a fucking rapey, racist fuckface. And that's our fucking issue? Is that a woman made a funny ass joke that if you can't take it? Then we're the bad guys. So yeah, I just got into a mild. The world is full of bullshit spiral today.
And what do you do when that happens? How do you get out of it? You put on a suit.
I took a nap and put a suit on.
Okay, yeah. That's nice.
A suit actually kind of makes up for lots of sadness.
Spencer?
More things, yes. He comes in with a 5-piece suit. Like, oh, rough day.
If you ever see me with an 11-piece suit. That means I have face shingles.
There's a tie on the back. It's everything.
What was yours? Let's go. Let's go down the line.
Good. Yeah. Let's say my high is being here. It's very exciting.
Nice.
And the low is for a split second I thought Rob would die, but then he started thrashing the bed.
There was a moment there I thought we might have committed a horrible crime there.
Yeah.
No, sir, her high was being on this show, and look what you did for the whole show. You caused her low.
I caused her low. I'm sorry.
That's actually my low is I told a rape joke earlier, and I can't tell if it was appropriate or not, but I went for it.
It's hard these days.
It is.
Back in the old days, it was so safe.
I made this space not safe.
No, no.
Like in person to people, or
it
did
was
you tell
on
me?
It was on the show. Oh, don't you remember?
Well, you were here, and not disgusted at all.
Oh yeah. I'm sorry. That was also my low.
Yeah.
Keith Malley.
My high would be being a resident of Harmontown for a minute. My low is the poor homeless person that's going to come across his bed and be so excited, and then lay in it for a second, and it breaks, and he has shingles. That's tough. Yeah. That's a tough day. That's the day you put on a couple suits, and he will.
Yeah.
Schrab, high low.
My high was having lunch with Kate. We've been we watched this have you seen this on Netflix, The Chef's Table? Have you seen the
not yet?
There's like an episode about like how this is how we got interested in going to a Buddhist temple, but there is like this Buddhist woman chef who was like talking about like how to eat and preparing food, and the thing that we've been trying lately is eating in silence and like taking a bite, putting your spoon or fork down and chewing it and being present and feeling the food in your mouth. And because like usually people are like eating while they're watching TV or checking their email or multitasking or whatever. You're not really, and you're just shoving food in your mouth.
Have you read the Celestine Prophecy?
What's that?
The Celestine Prophecy.
What, say again?
Have you read the Celestine Prophecy?
No, I haven't.
I guess no.
No.
Well, because they talk about
the Celestine Prophecy.
Yeah. But it is like that. It's just being very mindful and present. I've found by doing that the food that I'm eating tastes better, and I'm more satisfied, and I have like this more. And it's just it's a great time of the day.
Not for the waiter. That is a pain in the ass.
Well, we made our own food at home. Okay. But then
the Blue Apron, they provide you the ingredients.
And the low point was
I'm having the chicken fried cuckoosie with raisin bread barnesies.
My low point is Dan interrupting me.
Dan, high low.
My low point was saying goodbye to Cody before she had to go, and I knew I'd come to the show, and like she can't stay over tonight because she's got work in the morning, and who knows if we'll see each other tomorrow. So it was like, you know, it's at the end of a weekend, me having to come do this show. No offense to the people that enjoy it, although I don't understand your enjoyment for the last few episodes, it's just like traditionally Sunday nights before I come here are kind of a low because I'm like, weekend's over and like no more sleepovers with Cody. And we kind of wasted our time together. Sometimes I feel like we tried to watch that Hugh Jackman, P.T. Barnum, musical. And I was like,
Wolverine?
Hugh Jackman's playing Barnum?
Yeah, it's.
I was in that play when I was a kid.
And my high for real was just now when you guys started with your lows. My high was realizing that because I went off of Twitter when I got the shingles, I was like, okay, I'm not gonna think this Michelle Wolf thing. I don't even know who that is. What happened? I know it sounds like totally aggravating and upsetting, and I totally have no clue about it. And it's not like not knowing about the polar ice caps. It's like sounds like it's not knowing about some shit that's like just kind of
that you can avoid.
Yeah, like it sounds like I wasn't gonna help that subject. It was only gonna make me upset, you know. So I kind of feel like dodged a bullet, kind of high. Get off of that. I'm like, wow, that encourages me to stay off of. Yeah. Twitter.
The people who invented the word snowflakes got really hurt by a woman doing a joke about makeup, and everybody really went off the fucking handle.
We're going to make you know anyway what this world's like.
No, it's kind of like, I mean, I don't mind hearing all about the bullet I dodged. It's like, oh yeah, it was like a 22 with
I mean, also that can't really be my low. I think that was just, I think my low is being in a place where that was affecting me. Like it's like there's something lower than that that makes that even a thing that is on my radar.
Well, my new low is this having to be witness to this low backpedaling. I don't like this low, like finding out that lows
can
are.
Can I change my low? That my low is this awful, horrible fake ficus is behind you. This stricken.
I thought you were gonna say like this fern on your forehead, like is gonna start shingle shaming me.
I like that your low isn't even your shingles. So that you have other lows.
Oh yeah, you know what? You're right. I had shingles, and it should either be that my high is that they're kind of like done. You know, like I had a kind of a pain free day.
I might be imagining this, but they look less red than when the show started. I think you're actually healing as we watch.
Well, he's been passing them off.
The irony is that
the rest of your face is catching up.
You want to see them get scabbier like that. That's good news. Like when the scabbier they get.
Just don't pick them. You'll get a scar.
I wasn't
going
to pick the fucking herpes scabs.
Just don't pick at it.
Just don't worry him to death.
You got to. If you start picking at it, you're going to get a scar.
Also, my low is three, and it's not on my knee. It's a fucking herpes scar on my head. It hurts to.
Right. Just don't pick at it.
Dan, you're not concerned that DeMore just been sleeping.
He has every right to sleep.
It's a boring show.
He works hard.
What do you want DeMore to do?
He's taking it in.
Give him the bed.
No.
Sure. Okay.
DeMore, you want to get up here and crawl in the bed? Get some of that Harmon shingle.
Rob's kind of in it.
If you share a good high low in the bed, you can close the show unless Spencer.
Do I have to go underneath the bed again?
Church, you had a church.
We didn't hear from Spencer. High low.
Spencer, high low.
Oh,
high as it look like I could do fucking Dungeons and Dragons again.
I'm high as a kite, my man. Woo! And my low is just the rest of existence, I think.
Fair enough.
It's rough.
You got high low roaded, Dan.
Yeah, right. Dan, fucking stick it to that.
The only problem
answers.
I have with high low is that you no matter what you're ending on a low. There's no way it's gonna close the show.
Yeah, we should have.
That's
played
why
low,
we
high.
We added a what are you, like what did you learn from low and what are you grateful for?
Oh right.
Yeah.
I mean, we should have played you guys go last because you probably use it to close your shows and are good at making them good.
And I'm a piece.
What are you?
Of shit.
What are you doing? You're like a fucking cat. God damn it.
Stop it.
He fucking read it. Was so sad. He like, I got a tweet in my timeline back when I was on Twitter, and it said it was a guy saying like, I think you should bring Rob to Boston, and it said above it, Rob Schrab retweeted, because that's why it was in my timeline. And then you follow the eyeline, it was like three retweets, and you know that one of them is Rob.
Yeah.
By the way, I like all his talking about not being on Twitter anymore. That was yesterday, Dan.
It was like 2 days ago. Okay. That's a long time for a Twitter junkie. That's like, you know.
Baby steps, one day at a time. Did you get your chip?
Yeah, I deserve a big old chip for not knowing who Michelle Wolf is. Don't even know.
The closing song, Dan Harmon.
Should all.
You got some music for us, Zach? Or maybe not.
It's about time to learn what we learn.
What if he thinks he
talk
can?
About how we burn the herpes out our head. Don't let them get inside you. You gotta go wide. You gotta keep on rapping. At the end of the show, don't take a crap in to your butt. Get it outside. So what? Put it in the toilet. Flush it down. Fuck your mama like a clown. Put a red nose on hers. Fuck your mama in her purse. Climbed inside. Fucked your pussy. Gary Busey. Chemda, take it with the hook. The Rihanna hook.
Ooh, I got the shingles. And
shingles.
I don't need to worry about weird shit. Just
don't worry.
Escaping.
Yo.
Oozing
shingles ain't gonna worry.
Gap in my brain.
Yo.
It looks like I'm too smart for fine. Anyone.
Yo, shingles. Yo. All the shingle ladies. Yeah. Yo.
I'm a shingle ladies. I'm a shingle ladies. I'm a shingle ladies. I'm a shingle ladies.
Yo, yeah, yo, yo. Shingle, shingles, all the way.
Shingling, baby. Go ahead, baby. Shingling, baby. Go ahead, baby.
Yo. That's a shit. All right. Yo.
Just hear those Dan Harmon shingling a ring ting tingling too.
Blue apron. Yo. Blue apron.
General Sports Chicken.
Hymns for hymns. For hymns.com. For hymns.com. Yo. For hymns.com. Yo. For hymns.com. Yo. My dick don't work. My head is bald. gonna go to the website that called me to its adventure. I'm gonna fuck your mom in a second.
Boy, it always comes back to fucking moms.
Yeah, say they call it a crutch. But Starsky and Hutch also had a crutch. They got in their car and they drove too much, but you don't see them saying, hey, let's do that less. Yo.
It's the sexy show. We're sitting in bed and doing all the wrong.
Forhims.com. Forhims.com.
Sexy show.
Forhims.com.
Erectile.
Turn your boner on.
Get it in.
Get your hair
penis
growing like a
ball. Spencer, break it down.
What?
Spencer, break it down.
What? Spencer, turn my headphones up. Got what? Shingles on the face. In
I
the place.
I think Rob died anyway.
Human race. We're just shingles on the earth. Fill it out. Fill its girth. I am happy, full of mirth. Pretty high. David Firth.
Yay!
Cliffhanger! Let's thank our guests, Keith Malley and Chemda Khalili. Am I saying that correctly?
Yeah, thank you.
Rob Schrab, the Supine, and narrowly escaped from a horrible, crushing death. The Game Master, who didn't have to play a game, Spencer Crittenden.
We played high-low.
We played high-low.
And I win, right? I won?
I think everyone's a winner.
I don't think it was anything like red light, green light.
No.
No. I don't know.
That's a good
sorry
point.
Sorry to disappoint.
It didn't nowhere even compare to red light, green light. It wasn't even close.
Let's thank Church for the wonderful photos and videos that I'm hoping happen tonight from the madness. Sleepy Demorage out there, suffering from the horrible loss of Arsenal and the loss of your beloved manager of 22 years. How are you feeling about that, Demorage? 22 years is a long time. Let it go. I'm your comptroller, Jeff Davis. Your mayor is Dan Harmon. Let's thank Church and you, Song, and
you know,
Zach.
I don't
Chris
have to go
Kevin
to Boston
Levy,
if you don't want
the whole
me there
gang, Sarah, everybody back there doing cool things.
If you
cool
don't
things
want me to go to Boston, I don't have to go.
Thank you to Starburns.
You know, I don't want to go.
Thank
I'm not going.
Yeah, always to Starburns.
I'm not going to Boston.
Are we doing more shows here? Is this the end of this? Is this?
I think this is like the, what is it, when you go to the website and watch Bill Maher talk more about corn syrup and animals? I don't know.
Go to Boston. Go to Long Island. The Long Island show.
What's our
part
date
of
in
a
Boston?
Convention.
We're playing the Wilbur Theater the 22nd of which month? 22nd of June, the Wilbur Theater, which is a fantastic theater if you've not been there. It's one of
so
my favorite
good
venues in
historic
the in the continental U.S. It's a good time. We'll go get wicked retarded together and probably have some lobster or whatever the fuck. If they have vegan lobster, I'll have a vegan lobster.
It'll be wicked retarded.
But the retardedness will be, we can guarantee your wickedness and the retardedness.
Or your money back.
Or your money back. Rob Schrab will be there by his own self-proclamation.
No, I'm not.
Oh, come on.
No, no,
I beg
no
you now.
No, I don't want
anything else,
go
Levy? Is that... The Braille? The Cradle of Aviation
and that's
Museum.
Like, that's like through a convention.
The 23rd
or
something
of you June. You have to like join the convention or get tickets to that, and then it's part
in
of
Long
it
Island. It's Long Island. You have family
oh,
in Long
Island.
Island? They're all in Jersey.
My
it's
brother lives there.
We'll
now.
Where in Long Island?
Oh, it's terrible. It's so far
and
out.
And the humidity? Oy.
Oh, I hate it. You got to travel
why
by railroad.
Why do they call it Long Island?
But there's
Island
a place with an egg salad that is just a hook.
Oh, there's always egg salad, so it's kind of nice.
Yes.
But
no, I plot some nice filkester.
Compared to what? Why is it Long Island?
It's too long. It's Long Island. Anyway, you're going there? That's fantastic.
We're
going to
be in Long Island, apparently. And I love
La-Pot
it up there. Yeah. What's the city we're going to be in, Levy?
Long Island.
What's the town?
Long Island.
Can you believe this is a show?
Nah.
This is a show. That's
well,
great.
Can you believe the definition of show has changed this much?
It's almost like putting a bed on stage didn't lend itself to high energy.
Go to the Harmontown Instagram to see some choice boomerangs that Church did of Jeff sodomizing Rob with a foreign object.
Also, go to this ficus's GoFundMe page so we can get this moisture
it
before
wants
this
to
plant
turn into
dies.
Feed
me, Seymour. All right. Drive fast, take chances. We bid you a fond farewell. Zach, pump her up.
I got a headache.
Thanks for having us.
Did you get any of that?
It's a good show.